Welcome, everybody. This is the track, Many Ways to Build APIs. We are on stage two here. We will have three talks about different styles of building APIs. We will start with Nadja, who is head of customer success at dashdash. And that will be, let's say, in my view, a way to build APIs for first-time API builders. So it is like a novice mechanism for novices. So I'm actually curious to see how this will go. So now the stage, Nadja has the stage. And if you have any questions, just write them in the chat. And I will take her to relay them to Nadja.
Cool. Well, thank you so much, Vlad. Yeah, my name is Nadja Benes, and I run customer success at dashdash out of the Berlin office. And what dashdash is all about, I'll touch upon later. But in this session, it's actually not so much about like an alternative way of building APIs, but I think what's also very interesting is kind of alternative ways, especially in the no-code and low-code space, how to interact with APIs that you guys have basically built. And that's why I want to touch upon kind of how everyone can become a builder and create super powerful workflows by using some of those no-code and low-code tools that interact with APIs. So this is kind of my goal for this session today, and I hope you'll just get an overview of how those tools work in terms of like handling and disposing APIs and teaching novices, teaching people basically on how you what you can do with API connections, and so hopefully you will also be inspired to start building at the end. Well, if you take a look at large IT projects today, and large IT projects being those with initial price tags over $15 million, a majority of them actually face delays, right? They massively blow their budget, they deliver much less value than predicted. And many projects seem to be also cut out due to mismanagement of stakeholders and lacking project management skills, and therefore bad prioritization. And at the same time, and you probably noticed this maybe in some of your organizations, employees also start to look for tools that allow them to do their jobs faster and better and with greater ease. So without having, to rely on IT anymore to build the systems they need. So business people, this is also something that we've seen at dashdash, well, business people want to build their own and custom tools, but without code. Well, the good news is now you actually can. So there's a new wave or a big wave of no-code and low-code tools that enables you to do exactly that, give more responsibility to employees and remove the burden from IT. But large organizations want to remain in control still of the tools that their employees use. So if you think about it, like the average enterprise company uses about 1,000 SaaS tools. So it's already pretty hard to keep track on who's using what and control kind of the permission rights of the tools used. So CIOs, or if you ask them, CIOs are actually very afraid of relying on so-called shadow IT. So tools that are set up by someone, but then no one really controls, and that therefore risks to even break apart the company's infrastructure. So if you haven't heard about this so much not so much yet, let's just take a step back and look at the no-code movement. What is this whole thing about, and how can this be maybe relevant for your organization? Well, the no-code website builder Webflow puts it this way. It's basically an evolution of core principles that has driven technological innovation for hundreds of years, precisely the desire to democratize and scale processes, tools, and access to mediums, which were formerly available only to a small set of people, to software engineers, right? So today, you no longer need to be a developer to build things on the internet. Thanks to the variety of the no-code and low-code tools out there, anyone basically with a computer and internet access can build a website or an app, a CRM, an online shop. And these tools are really reducing the amount of time and coding expertise required to translate an idea into something that people can actually use. So therefore, building and creating is much more accessible and empowering a lot of new makers coming from very, very different backgrounds and perspectives. And anytime you can remove, I mean, an engineer's time from the project equation, you're not only saving them a bunch of time working on something more important, and most likely they have more important work to do, but you're also saving a lot of money, right? So as you can see, there are no-code and low-code solutions for really all sorts of problems that you previously needed engineers and data scientists to do. So from building a product, a website, a web app, a mobile app, accessing APIs, which is going to be my focus today, and creating databases or, yeah, building automated workflows. So there's a plethora of tools out there, and I wanted to pick the workflow builders today and explore the differences in how they let you interact with APIs. And this is also, I think, important for you guys as you're exposing your own organizational APIs. How easy is it for those no-code and low-code tools to plug in with them and to allow business people really to create the workflows they need? And thanks to those tools, and I think this is also why it's so important, really anyone can build advanced and fully automated workflows without spending months and thousands of dollars building. Well, very familiar to you probably, the market leader out there when it comes to connecting different APIs is Zapier. They monitor thousands of APIs for those triggers. So for example, if there is a form submitted or a new lead comes through your website, and basically let you automate what happens after that trigger. So maybe a new row in your Google Sheet gets created or in your Airtable, or a new lead is sent into Salesforce. So you create those workflows, they call it Zaps, in a very intuitive kind of drop-down interface, as you can see here as well, where you go really through a step-by-step process. You don't see any data. It's really just like different toggles to pick, different services and actions and triggers and actions to pick. They really have an impressive amount of APIs that can be integrated out of the box. I think it's more than 1,500 apps. It's also quite a price point at the beginning, but I think, yeah, for the ease of use, definitely worth it for one-way app-to-app integrations, right? So when X happens, then you want Y and Z to happen as well instantly. However, if you need integrations or kind of like different APIs going both ways between those APIs, so if you're looking for deeper logic options within each API, and also, especially if you need to aggregate and reformat data from multiple sources, definitely check out Integromat or Parabola. They might be the better choice for you here. And also interesting how they take a different approach when it comes to those like workflow builders and like API connectors, because what they do, you can see it here in the preview, they use a visual flowchart style, right? The flowchart is kind of nice to understand the setup and also shows you how the data flows through the scenario you've created. So the circles are the web apps and each line is kind of a trigger or a rule. And Integromat, they also monitor hundreds of applications for triggers, so just like Zapier, but they can import data from applications also on scheduled runs. So you can import all Google Sheet data every hour and then transform your data as well with custom functions. You can process past data. They also support advanced logic, kind of if-then type step operations, and the ability to call any API, of course. So for more complex workflows, I think Integromat is really something to consider. Also, what's interesting, Parabola, the other kind of connector, API connector tool here, they start with a slightly different idea than the trigger and action idea. So Parabola really starts with the premise of importing tables. So they're also plenty of data transformation steps at your disposal when you work with Parabola, allowing you to change the data any way you need it. And then you can either export it just in raw or also via API connection, ideally. So if your workflow really requires you to import data sets, so if, for example, you wanted to update the number of page views in Webflow every hour with data from Google Analytics, then Parabola might be a good tool to consider doing that. Interesting here, Integromat also allows you to import tables, but really treats the tables differently than Parabola, which just does a much better job on like visualizing, see the data you're manipulating, and also immediately see the results of the operations you performed on your data. So that's just like kind of like a taste question also for you to check out when you're exploring those different tools. In general, Parabola has fewer direct integrations than Integromat and also Zapier. So it offers this like drag and drop graphic experience for very few tools only. But since, I mean, most tools, and hopefully yours as well, have an easy to work with API, it's pretty straightforward to plug those in if you're confident in working with APIs. Of course, it's kind of always a precondition. So one way of extracting and manipulating data from various APIs is, as shown by these tools here, in those graphic drag and drop interfaces, right? With flowcharts like Parabola and Integromat do it. But of course, those tools still have quite a steep learning curve, right? They have all those like custom ways of building those triggers and rules. So what about actually accessing APIs from an interface that everyone understands, which is a simple spreadsheet? In a recent podcast on the Investors Field Guide, Stripe co-founder John Collison actually said that no one calls Excel a no-code tool, but that it's actually one of the most underappreciated programming environments in the world. So the number of Excel programmers versus people using how we think of as more traditional programming languages is really something to take note of. And we at dashdash actually did notice this. Obviously, we're not the only ones, but that's also why we've built a tool that lets you interact with APIs from a spreadsheet, which I love to talk to you about a little bit more. So first off, dashdash really is a real spreadsheet, right? So you can use the same math or logic functions that you love already from Excel or Google Sheets. We support the top 100 spreadsheet functions, but you can also interact with APIs. It's really the main value proposition directly from a spreadsheet cell. So we have a bunch of kind of out of the box instant integrations already on our marketplace, like Crunchbase, Hunter, Zero Bounds, HubSpot, Build With, Twitter, Instagram, many more. And each of those integrations basically unlocks custom formulas that you can then use to send and retrieve data to those services, to their APIs. So one example use case that's widely used, especially from sales organizations, and here again, these are not developers, right? These are business people who are building these workflows using the different integrations that we offer. So they find and enrich companies with data from Crunchbase, then they track down the right points of contacts at those organizations with LinkedIn, taking this data input, they're basically finding the email address of those people found with Hunter. They're then validating those email addresses with Zero Bounds and automatically send them back to their HubSpot CRM. So it's really like a chain, like data is created from one API call, then this is used as an input for your next API connection using a different service. So for each integration on our marketplace, we're basically translating their API endpoint requests, if you will, into Excel-like looking formulas. So one formula, for example, looks like this: search companies Crunchbase, right? So very intuitive. And when you type these formulas also, which are basically API requests, we help you and guide you through building the request. So which parameters are mandatory, which ones are only optional, also how you format those parameters. So it's really kind of like guiding someone who maybe has never executed an API request before to actually getting to it pretty fast. And when you successfully executed a function and therefore kicked off an API request, you can also then view the API response, so the JSON object, in the spreadsheet cell. And then you pick just the variables that you want to display on your table. You can do this with also custom functions and have your data nicely displayed in a spreadsheet table. You then transform it, you can filter it, sort it, add some if logic, or as I said before, basically take that data as an input and do something else with another service with it, right? And the good thing is also that for a majority of those data integrations, you do not even have to have a subscription with those services. So we're also not only, you know, just putting those APIs for connection in there, but we're also reselling their data. So you connect through us and you're able to purchase the data on an on a per API request level from us instead of the service itself. Probably more interesting to you if you're not so, if you more care about your custom APIs, well, the integrations on our marketplace are definitely not the limit, right? So you, we have custom functions, get, put, post functions that allow you to connect to any API that supports JSON as an object and extend dashdash really with your own back office and favorite business tool. So here in this example, I integrated with the GitHub API via our custom get function. So this one is public, doesn't require any authentication. But of course, for many other APIs, the authentication is done via the API keys, which you just simply pass directly in the URL off as another parameter. We also, of course, I mean, APIs have many different authentication methods. So sometimes you have to build those authentication headers in your GET or POST request. So bearer authentication method or basic authentication where you pass it as a base 64 encoded string containing a username and a password. That's also pretty easy to do in a spreadsheet with our pair to JSON function. So this function basically allows you to combine any a cell combination and turn a JSON, turn it into a JSON, right? So later when you construct your get or a post request, you can just refer to this spreadsheet cell as your authentication header. So plenty of flexibility here in terms of custom APIs. And when you're done with it, and when you're or when our users are done building a really cool workflow, it's very nice that they can also publish the spreadsheet as a fully functional web app. So they can basically, you know, plug in all sorts of APIs, build this workflow, but then relay it as a web app rather than just, you know, the spreadsheet to their team members so that they're more productive too with a workflow that has been created, or even clients, right? So we work with a lot of people that use dashdash as their front end to basically have an interface to interact with their back end with their APIs. So this is also, I think, good to know. Well, this has just been a tiny peek into this huge no-code and low-code landscape and how these tools can be handy to interact or integrate a bunch of different APIs, hopefully also yours. I guess what all those low-code and no-code tools have in common is that they really empower, right? And whereas before no-code, you could pretty much only create documents or presentations or spreadsheets, well, now you can actually also create websites and apps and retrieve data and build automated workflows. So you're now able to really complete the tasks that were previously owned by the IT gods, I always like to say. And yeah, and also the distribution of those tools is pretty impressive. So productivity apps, cloud APIs, automation software have more than 1 billion users. So there's more than $100 billion in this market. And when you're eager to experiment with any of those no-code tools, or maybe you're also thinking about building one yourself, you're part of the industry, I think it's I want to kind of send you off with this little checklist here. Always ask yourself, yeah, how is it connected to your different tools? Is the learning curve very steep in terms of connecting to custom APIs? What are the automation capacities, of course? And yeah, for you as a company or for the industry as a whole, I always like to kind of talk about the ease of migration of the workflows. Because if you look at the landscape right now, there are lots of competing standards, right? So you cannot export a zap into an integromat or into a parabola, right? So the industry, I think, in the future will need to consolidate around a standard or really become open source long term. And then, of course, yeah, always check whether the community is contributing features. Are there like template example solutions that let you work faster and get started faster? At dashdash, we're pretty proud to be a part of this movement. And if you're interested in interacting with APIs and building advanced workflows in a spreadsheet, maybe also, as I showed you before, like publish a spreadsheet that connects to your own organizational API and relay this to clients, definitely hit me up. I'd be very happy to onboard you to our beta. Thank you.
Thanks, Nadja, for an interesting presentation. It's kind of amazing how new UI paradigms emerge all the time. So things that in the past have been complicated or, let's say, accessible to few, they are now simpler and using weird, like from a traditional perspective, weird UIs, like a cell in a spreadsheet is like the interface to the API call. So we have some questions here. So I'm actually quite happy that somebody asked it, because I was going to ask it myself. So I have, or in the demo, you have shown that some of the cells can contain the API keys or the tokens. Mm-hmm. How do you handle? So first of all, this is like, is it limited to specific API standards, or you have a broader range of ways to interact with APIs from security standpoint?
Yeah, very, very good question. So first of all, kind of like connecting to dashdash with your API, it needs to support JSON as a content type. So we connect to any RESTful API that supports JSON. In terms of authentication, well, OAuth 2.0 is possible too, to definitely integrate with those APIs that require that authentication method in dashdash. The only difference is that you basically get an authorization token with a first get or post function, and then pass this token as a parameter with a second get or post function. So there are, yeah, I mean, all the main authentication types for APIs we do support.
Okay, thank you. And now my question. So you make so easy now to call these APIs. And so if you do it traditionally, where you go to Postman and you are exposed to all the, let's say, the inner workings of the API, you would be aware about the security implications. So here, like copying keys in Excel sheets, sharing them or giving access is just opening some another vector of leaking secrets. Like there have been quite many stories about somebody publishes on GitHub Amazon tokens, and then suddenly they get huge bills. So are you like considering or how do you see this kind of issues?
Yes, I mean, we are our own spreadsheet, right? It's not like copying it in Excel, but it's in a dashdash spreadsheet, of course. And yet there are, I mean, I can totally understand that there are concerns. I mean, our tool is end-to-end encrypted, really, like any other accounting software. It's we don't access the data as a company, and also no one else should. So the encryption is definitely there, but I think, yeah, honestly, we're as encrypted and as safe as any other accounting tool. It's really what I always say, and we comply with a 256 encryption standards. Honestly, I mean, from the users that we have had in the past, that actually wasn't their main concern to store keys in the spreadsheet for now, at least.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much for the presentation. And I ask you to join now to leave the backstage and join for the final Q&A session.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for listening. Bye.
Thank you.